What is the effect of adding ethanol to gasoline?
Hi everyone, this is Albert again. On our last video, Pablo told us about the difference between ideal and non-ideal mixtures through the example of gasoline and water. However, I still have some questions for him. I wonder where did he disappear?
Hi Albert, are you looking for me?
Yes. Recently, there has been a lot of discussion about the addition of green fuels, also called biofuels, into gasoline. Could you please tell me more about it? And are these green fuels the same than biogasoline, which you mentioned on our last video?
Very good question, Albert. Biofuels refers to fuels which have some component made from biological sources. A very good example is biogasoline. Biogasoline is formed by a mixture of gasoline and bioethanol, which can be produced from different sources, like sugarcane and corn.
I see. Actually, I remember you told us about the difference between ideal and non-ideal mixtures, and you also mentioned that ethanol can mix both gasoline and water. So, does this mean that ethanol and gasoline will form an ideal mixture?
Well, I'll try to explain you once again. Ethanol has an apolar tail, which is formed by the carbon-carbon bond, and a polar head, formed by the hydroxy group. The hydroxy group is highly electronegative, and thus gives the ethanol molecule a polar character. Due to a combination of an apolar tail and a polar head, the stickiness, the bond energy of the molecule, is halfway between that of water and an equivalent alkane. This means that ethanol mixes entirely well with both water and gasoline.
I see, but why should I care about water?
What do you mean?
I mean, I cannot put water in my fuel tank, so why should I be concerned about the mixing of ethanol and water?
Obviously, but don't you know that water is required in order to produce ethanol?
Actually, the only thing that I know is that ethanol is produced by fermentation, which was mentioned by you on our last video.
Very good memory, Albert. It's good that you remember that, because it's this fermentation process only which requires water.
Whoa, that sounds interesting. Could you please give me more details about how is bioethanol produced?
No problem, Albert. Plants are composed of a starch and cellulose, both of which are made up of sugar. This sugar has to be mixed with water before mixing it with yeast, which ferments to form ethanol and carbon dioxide. At this point, ethanol is present in a solution with water, which needs to be removed. This separation is carried out through distillation, which gives us hydrous ethanol, with the maximum yield of 95% of ethanol. Afterwards, the hydration is carried out, generally using molecular sieves, to obtain the fuel grade of ethanol, which is around 99.5%. This step is very energy intensive.
Thank you, Pablo. I now understand why you talked about the mixture of ethanol and water, but why is the complete separation of these two compounds not possible during distillation?
This is because water and ethanol form an azeotrope.
Azeo-what?
Azeotrope, literally meaning no change in boiling. Such mixtures have the same composition in the liquid and vapor phase.
Wait, I'm lost. On our second video, you told us that the liquid and vapor phases have different compositions, and this is also the reason why several stages are needed during distillation.
Well, this is real for near ideal mixture. Yet ethanol and water, because of their hydrogen bond, behave in such a way that, at specific composition, the liquid phase structure is more stable than either of the pure components. The phase envelope that we saw earlier therefore changes and becomes a zone.
This is funny. It looks like two equilibrium curves next to each other.
Yeah, that's exactly what it is. It's as if the zoetropic composition was a pure component on its own in the figure.
I see, but I still don't understand why we cannot produce 100% ethanol from distillation.
Well, let me try to explain you. Let us say that we start boiling a mixture of ethanol and water, in which the composition of ethanol is C1%. As you can see from the vapor phase curve, the solution will boil to give a vapor mixture in which the concentration of ethanol is C2%. During distillation, we will condense this vapor and boil it again. When we do that, we will obtain a vapor mixture of C3%. If you carry out subsequent distillation, you will eventually reach the maximum concentration of ethanol attainable, that is to say, 95.6%.
Wow, that's so interesting, and let me try to guess ahead. At 95.6 purity, if we boil the liquid, we will obtain a vapor with the same composition. And on the other side, if we condense these vapors, we will obtain, again, a liquid with the same composition. We have reached like a sort of barrier.
Perfect, Albert. At this point, the liquid starts boiling at a single temperature and has the same composition of the liquid and vapor phase. Hence, it's behaving as a pure liquid.
Aha! I now understand why different alcoholic beverages are priced differently. More the alcohol content, the more has been the processing reached in order to remove water from the mixture.
Well, it's a way to look at it, but your logic is correct. See, thermodynamics is everywhere, from biofuels to alcoholic beverages.
Biofuels? Wait! I remember you told me that ethanol can mix both water and gasoline, but how do all these compounds behave as a whole mixture?
Excellent question, Albert. Till now, we were dealing with two components, so we use binary phase diagrams. For three components, we have three different binary diagrams. If we combine all the three binary phase diagrams between the respective components, we will form a triangle, which can be used to show the phase behavior. This is called a ternary diagram. This diagram shows the physical behavior of mixture at different compositions. Along the side of the triangle, we still have a binary mixture. But when a third component is added, we move to a region inside the triangle. For example, if we have a mixture of gasoline and water, and we start adding ethanol, we will lie on different regions inside the triangle, depending on the ethanol concentration. The same can be said about adding gasoline to ethanol-water mixture, and adding water to ethanol-gasoline mixture. To study the physical behavior of this mixture of three components, you can draw a curve showing the phase split between the respective components. For example, the phase split between water and gasoline follows this curve. From this curve, we can see that if we have a mixture of gasoline and water, we are in the red zone. That is to say, the two components don't mix with each other. That is why, in order to have an ideal mixture of gasoline, that is, lie in the green zone, we first take a mixture of ethanol and water, having a very high concentration of ethanol, and then mix it with gasoline. Remember when I said that the dehydration step in bioethanol production is very energy intensive? This is the reason we need to carry out that step, because if we don't have a very high purity of ethanol, the mixture of bioethanol and gasoline won't mix.
Wow, that's so cool! Everything makes sense now. I'm really interested in thermodynamics now. Could you please tell me something about the research in this field?
Well, we're trying to correctly predict the phase behavior of different components. You remember the phase curve you saw before? Mm-hmm. People are trying to develop mathematical models which correctly predicts the phase behavior of different mixtures. This involves the simultaneous application of different fields of science. It's quite a demanding task, and requires the participation of bright and inquisitive minds like you, Albert. We really hope that you found our short video series informative and interesting. On behalf of the whole TERG team, I really thank you for your kind attention. Wishing you a good day.
And as we say in Spain, hasta pronto!